All right, so in line with what I did last week, I thought I'd give a few hints about this week 8 program that has to do with the try and catch. So if I say public class, whatever. Public static void main. All right, so we've got our structure of our program here. I'm going to be highly surprised if there's not already a whatever that exists. Actually, I probably name this something more. Let me week 8 help. That'll be more. And I can save it in this examples folder with the other stuff. Okay, so the basic concept of this chapter is super easy. So we say scanner in equals new scanner system dot in. So that allows us to read in some input. I say I want a number, whatever it is. Number of championships for the Cubs. I know nothing about baseball. It's baseball season though, right? Oh well. So I'm asking the user system.out.println how many championships do the Cubs have? This is just funny because I'm trying to figure out where that example came from. Let's see. Let's find out. How many championships do the Cubs have? Chicago Cubs. Two. 1907, 1908. They're due. Okay, I don't know if there are any Cubby fans out there. I would say it's boring to watch baseball, but the truth is, I love to watch golf, and people think that's boring. So, I'm sure there's something exciting about baseball. Import java.util.scanner to be able to read in this stuff, and then I'm going to store that input. So, num championships Cubs is equal to in.next. Int. I want to read it in an integer using my scanner method that I've called int, and I want to store it in this num championships cubs variable. Okay, so everything is happy, everything is fine until, so as soon as I say two, and that's fine. Three is fine. Four is fine. Five is fine. You'll have to forgive me. I've had a serious lack of sleep last night. My 2-year-old daughter had her first nightmare about a spider with red eyes that was on her bed. And she was quite freaked out about that. So we brought her in bed with us. And then, just as soon as we drift off to sleep, she would say, she'd sit up real fast and, "Spider, spider." What? I'd flip on the light and she'd look at the bed and go, "Oh, ha 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 ha." And then she'd lay back down, and then she'd start to drift off to sleep again. And then as soon as we all started going to sleep again, "Piter, Piter." So that was my night. I'm tired. Anyway, okay, so everything's fine until we try to enter something. Hello. Then we get an exception. So that's the whole point of this week, is that we can take this code and put it into a safe zone. This is like wearing your seatbelt. We can put it in this try and say, okay, anything that's inside the try is now safe as long as we tell it what to do when we catch it. And so we say catch, and in this case, I can see what the error is. It's an input mismatch exception. Now I can just do a general IO exception. I can do, I think, just an exception. I can't remember if that's exactly what it's called, but I can just do a generic catch any error. But in this case, I want to catch this one specific error for input mismatch exception. And so I can say, okay, go to, this is an input mismatch exception that I want to catch. And so catch input mismatch exception, and then I'm going to call that input mismatch exception that's being passed to me, E. So now I can do something when that error gets caught. So I can compile. Input mismatch exception. Hang on, there's an incredible amount of noise outside my window. Let me look. It was like a helicopter or something like that was taking off right outside my window. I don't know what that was. I don't know if you could hear it on the mic. Okay, so I'm catching cannot find symbol. Oh, I need to, that's right. You know, really the best thing to do probably is just say asterisk, and then we'll get all the classes that are included with the util. Util is a library we use a lot, but otherwise we need to go import that error specifically. So I run this, and I say, how many championships do the Cubs have? Well, now if I type hello, it gives me an error instead of crashing like it did before. The first time I did that, I got this crash and the program stopped. This way I can handle the error. And so all of this up to this point is just review of what we've done in the chapter. The part, there's two things that trip students up, I think, on this particular assignment. The first thing that I see is that, well, there's a few things I'll talk about. One is that we're asking for a couple different pieces of information, height and weight. If they enter, what I see a lot of times is both the height and weight are put into the same try. And so if I enter a correct height and then I enter an incorrect weight, then the error is caught and it will have me go back and re-enter the height, which is annoying because I entered that one incorrectly. Why do I have to go back to the beginning? And so one thing just to know that I can't remember if I talked about in the lectures or not, is that you can have multiple tries and catches in a program. You can have 10 different tries and catches to handle different sections of the program, handle different errors. So we don't just need to use one. The other thing is that a lot of times students will go and then put here, say, bad input. And again, I can't remember exactly what I did in the lecture, so I apologize if this is a repeat. So bad input, retry, and then I give them another shot. So now if I say hello, then it says, oh, I didn't flush the buffer. So let me do that. I think I'm sure we talked about that in the lecture that we need. There's still a bad input is in the buffer. So if we try and read it again, we'll get trouble. So I'll do it in dot next line, which reads in the whole, anything that's in the buffer gets read out by a next line. So now I say hello, and good. It caught the error. It says bad input, and then retry. Well, the problem is, if I type hello again, because I'm a not so bright user, then the program crashes, and the reason it crashed is because this is not in a seatbelt. It's not safe because it's not inside a try. It's inside the catch, and so we're going to get that error. And so the biggest part to this, and I'm thinking I did talk about this in the lectures, but I can't remember exactly, is how do we, because we're getting bad input here, we want to not do anything inside the catch. We basically want to say go back to this line. In the really old days of programming, you would just say go to line 15. So you'd go specifically to that line. Well, we don't have that ability, or even if we do have that ability, it's not good programming. It's very hard to trace. And so what we do, and this is something, again, we may have addressed, is put this whole thing inside a loop. And so it'll keep doing it over and over again as long as they have an input, good input. So now we've got this whole thing inside a do while. But what's the condition? The condition is, yeah, that's fine. We can keep doing this over and over again, but how do I know that there's bad data in there? Well, again, what we can do is just simply, and there's a lot of different ways to do it. We could go check the input, we could read it in, see what it is, let the user know, especially if we want to get more specific error messages. But a really simple way of doing it is just to create a Boolean variable and say is error or has error, however you want to put it. And say that's false initially, then down here in the catch, when we get the bad input, we can say, and by the way, set has error to true. And then the while can just be as long as we have an error, as long as we has error, then we're going to keep doing this. Missing a brace there. And by the way, the reason I knew I was missing a brace is because I had a closing brace that wasn't out on the level. I said, wait, that one goes with that one, so there's got to be a brace that's missing. So if I compile and run this now, then how many championships do you have? And I say, hello. Then it says bad input, retry, and then goes back up to the top and says, oh, okay, ask again. How many championships do you have? Well, now if I enter bad data again, it will do the same thing. The problem is going to be if I enter good data, two, then it's going to ask me again, how many championships do you have? Well, the problem is once has error has a true in it, there's nothing else in the loop to set it back to a false. And so yeah, so we keep looping because has error never changes, and it's just going to be an infinite loop this way. And so what I want to do is when I come back into the try, I want to reset things. So I'm going to make has error back into a false so that it'll, like I said, reset. So I say two and everything's fine. If I say hello and then two, then everything's fine because has errors back to a false. I get the correct data and then I get out of this method and go on to the next thing. Now, a number of people already this semester, when I say a number, a few, two or three people have written me saying, I can't figure out how to make a negative, how to account for a negative number. And sometimes we make things more difficult than they need to be because what they're thinking is there's a catch property that if it's negative, then it's going to do this thing. And that's, I mean, we can do fun, fancy things. I think I've mentioned at least a couple of you that there is you can create your own error messages based on certain criteria and then throw those error messages and handle them. And, this programming stuff gets a lot more complicated. But you don't need that because you could have handled the negative numbers in week three or week two, whenever we first did that. All we're doing with the negative numbers is to check to see if it's negative. And if it's negative, then we're going to have them enter it in again. That's nothing to do with the try catch. It's very simply, I was going to say, an if statement. But the problem is, what if they enter it more than once? And so this falls into the same category of they didn't enter a rock or they didn't put the correct number of games. We're just going to throw them into a loop that says, as long as the number that they entered is negative, then ask them, say, sorry, can't be a negative number, please try again. And then we do read in their input again inside the loop because we're going to have them keep doing it until they get a positive number. Now, where do we want that negative check to be? Do we want it to be inside the catch? Well, no, because inside the catch, it only happens if they typed in bad data. So that wouldn't make sense to put the negative there. Do we want it after the try catch? Like down here? Well, the problem is, what if they enter, so what if they enter hello? So let's say they enter a negative 5, and then the next time around they enter hello. Well, now we've got a problem because it's going to crash the program again. It's not inside the safe zone. And so the negative number check needs to be there inside the safe zone, but after we've gotten the data. So they're gonna input the data, and then we can examine the data, just like before we had ever even knew about a try catch. We can examine the data to see is it good data in terms of logical, not anything to do with Java. Like Java can't read in a word into an integer variable, but a negative number is perfectly legal to read in Java. So then we need to do our own little check saying, wait a second, is this number negative? If it is, then tell them it's negative and you can't do that. Please enter another number. And then if they enter some garbage, we're still inside the catch and it will jump into the catch and go through that normal process. So anyway, hopefully that's helpful. Just a few hints to get you along your way with this program. I'll try to get some sleep so I'm more coherent next time. And let me know if you have any questions. Spencer out.